Hello everybody, this is going to be a guide on how to install Arch Linux on top of btrfs. I watch a lot of video tutorials on YouTube. I feel like they have definitely helped me learn Linux quite a lot, and I looked around and I didn't see any kind of installation guide for btrfs, so I decided to make one. This isn't going to be an in-depth install. This is basically just going to be about how to install Arch Linux on btrfs and a few of the things that go along with it. What is btrfs? So btrfs is a really cool file system. It's supposed to be the next new file system for Linux. Whether or not that's actually the case, who knows. But it does some really cool stuff, like it features copy on write. So what copy on write is basically if you have a file, let's say it's just a big text file, and you go in and you change a couple characters at the end, instead of rewriting the whole file or just rewriting the chunks that you change, what it does is actually keeps the original file and then just changes, puts, your changes off to the side. So then it does some really cool stuff with snapshotting. So if you were to say take a snapshot of the file before you commit and made these changes, you can actually just completely roll back right to the original state of that file and just, trash the changes. You can also do revisioning. So like if you just have, you can have multiple versions of this file with a whole bunch of changes that go with it. It also does some really cool stuff with RAID. So with RAIDs, you can, change your RAID configuration on the fly. You can go from RAID 1 to RAID 0 to RAID 10 to, back to RAID 1. You can add disks, you can take disks out of RAID, you can do a whole bunch of cool stuff right with it all live. That's the cool part, is like if you wanted to change, like if you had a 4-disk RAID 1 and you want to change that to a 4-disk RAID 10, there's not very much you would have to do. You just issue the command and it actually works in the background. You don't have to unmount anything. You don't have to, tell people working on your Samba share, hey, the server's going down. No, it just does it right live. That's awesome. It's also flash optimized. Trim support, all that good stuff, all right built into the file system. This is also really cool, like when you start talking about like transparent compression, especially with SSDs. So btrfs supports transparent compression. On SSD, let's talk about our big text file again. Basically, if you have text files, they compress really easily. You can take your big text file, compress it down pretty small, and then all you have to do is write that one little bit on the drive instead of this whole big thing. Now, of course, it does use a little bit extra CPU power to compress it, but generally speaking, your writes are going to be a lot faster with an SSD with the LZO compression. Now, if you were to, what's really cool is when you go and read this little file on the disk, and it basically becomes uncompressed, it just explodes in your RAM. It's pretty awesome. With the zlib compression, like that's, if you have a spinning hard drive, that's will gain you a little bit of speed here and there, but basically that's for archiving, so you can actually shrink, files a little bit on disk, maybe save a little bit of space. That being said, we should probably just go ahead and start firing up our VM right now. This will take about a second to boot. I'm probably going to get into a lot of the other cool features of btrfs, like snapshotting and RAID and that kind of stuff, in the second video. This is going to be the first of three. In the third video, I'll probably talk about some of the gotchas, like how to look at spare space on btrfs, because it's a little different. Also, disabling copy on write. If you have like a database file, or if you have a virtual box image like this, you need to disable copy on write, or else you'll get like weird space issues. As you can see, I have one 8 GB disk on my system, so let's just go ahead and start partitioning it. Cool. Usually with Linux systems, it's all up to popular opinion. People will either make like they'll make a slash boot partition, they'll make a slash home partition, and a slash root partition, and, you know, you can do whatever you want on your system. Personally, what I like to do is, because ButterFS has subvolumes, I like to treat, you know, subvolumes kind of can be treated like a partition and also like a folder at the same time. They're pretty cool like that. So, like, basically, like, if you have a server with long uptime, you know, sometimes you have to worry about, like, slash var filling up the whole, you know, the boot disk. With ButterFS, you can use quota, and you can issue quota to, you know, to that subvolume and say, hey, I don't want this subvolume to get over a certain size. And that's basically what I like to do with my disks, like on my laptop that I'm recording from right now. So anyways, let's just go ahead and create our ButterFS file system. So mk ButterFS. I like to label it. So also, like, if this is where we'd be starting, like, with a raid, this would be where we would throw in, you know, all the different disks. Now, of course, we could just start off with this one disk. It really doesn't matter. So we'll just go ahead and hit the enter key. And also, you'll notice that that was actually pretty much instant. ButterFS is really cool with the way that it just starts off with what you need. There's a lot of confusion sometimes when you look at some of the disk-free utilities that you have to use with ButterFS because it is copy-on-write. You can't just use df anymore. You know, sometimes a little bit confusing because you'll see, oh, I have 20 gigs, but then it says I have 22 gigs free. How does that work? Well, what ButterFS does is actually will format more of the disk as you need it. So it starts off with a very small amount right now, and then as you start filling it up, it actually will start working on disk and, you know, give you more of what you need as you go. SDA1 slash mount. Now, what I like to do, again, is I like to start with one, with multiple subvolumes. So I'll start with one subvolume, and then I'll unmount and then remount, mounting just that subvolume, and then going in and creating my other nested subvolumes. So capital. Oh, I need to do go into mount. Cool. So we create our root subvolume. So cd slash. Okay, cool. And then you mount. Cool. And then mount. Oh, so now we can throw in some of our options. So, like, I like to throw in SSD because I'm on an SSD and I told VirtualBox to make this an SSD drive. Compress. No wait time. I like no wait times. Makes it a little bit quicker. You don't have to throw in discard because of the SSD. It actually automatically turns it on. So that's, again, a lot of the flash storage awareness that ButterFS has. And then you also just need to throw in subvol equals root for our root partition, and then subdA1 submount. And go in, we are mounted, and then ButterFS. Now I can go ahead and create any subvolume I want from here. I usually like to just create some of the basic ones, some of the top level ones that are not virtual file systems, like you know, slash sys or, you know, slash proc or whatever. So, like, for example, like, create home root c mount opt var and tap. Oh, and so, of course, just all the big top level ones. I know temp is a virtual file system, but I like to have temp as a subvolume as well. Worth pointing out that you can't use bracket expansion for this. I don't know why. I've tried to use bracket expansion. In fact, actually, a lot of the bracket expansion just doesn't work with a lot of the btrfs commands. Don't know why. But hey, look at that. We're done already. So now, the ls, you can see that I have all of my folders I need. So let's go back out and then extract. The standard Arch Linux install doesn't come with btrfs progs, so we'll just throw that in. And of course, you can also just throw in whatever else you want here, but this looks good. Now, I won't bore you guys with sitting around waiting the probably 15 minutes it's going to take for me to download all these packages, because I have slow internet. So I'll just go ahead and just pause the video right here, and we'll pick up right where I left off. Okay, it's just been done installing, so we'll go into and we'll just do all the basic things that you usually do with an Arch Linux installation, and then we'll reboot just as proof of concept, show you guys that it worked. So let's join this tab, tech u tech p slash mount into slash mount slash tab. And as you can see, as we cat the FS tab of our new installation, that you have all your compression and your subvolume and all your good stuff, your label, all that stuff right there. So already success. So now let's mount. So now we're in our new installation. So now let's see, call do all the things. Where is the user share zone info America New York C slash local. One more time. Yeah. Contact 2OHC. Cool. And oh, we need grub. That's what we need. So we'll just wait for this to download. Can't type today, sorry guys. Boot grub config grub install slash dev sda. I should have finished by now. There we go. So it's finished. And then I'm going to do the reboot off of camera, just because I have i3 and I need to go tell VirtualBox to kick out the install media. So we'll just pause right here. Cool. So it's rebooting right now. We should see the fruits of our labor here in a second. And there we go. So if we go ahead and log in, you can see, I mean, there isn't much going on here. It's a fresh install, but hey, it works. So as you can see, I mean, btrfs, a little bit different than ext4, creating subvolumes, installing on subvolumes, that kind of stuff. There are some things you can do with grub. You can install, there's a grub btrfs package in the AUR. That will do btrfs check, fs check on boot, which isn't really needed, to be honest. But actually, if we were to cat /etd/default/grub and pipe that, let's go more. It doesn't actually say UUID root. Yeah, root equals dev disk. No. Anyways, shit. Anyways, whatever. I was going to show you guys where it's actually showing where the subvolume and that kind of stuff is. I guess that's actually under grub config, now I think about it, in /boot. Because this is just the script that it runs off of. So, yeah. Anyways. So next video we'll be showing you like taking snapshots. It'll be showing you how to start a raid and all the raid features, copying, how quick copies can be, and then the third video is going to be, you know, the gotchas, you know, your storage problems, why df doesn't work, you know, problems with mounting without compression on. That's bad. Don't do that. I've done that a couple times. Don't do that. So, that's where I'm going to end this video. And I'll upload to YouTube. And I'll have the other ones following shortly. Bye.